So the woman in cabin 10 is about a young journalist called Laura Blacklock, and she goes on the assignment of a lifetime. It's a big professional moment for her. She's on a trip called the Aurora Borealis, and in the middle of the night, she hears a sound, and it sounds to her like something being pushed overboard. So she runs to the side of her cabin and she looks over at the sea and she sees what she thinks is a body disappearing into the waves. Of course, she calls the ship's security and she goes next door to try and find out, you know, if the passenger is okay. But not only is there not a passenger in the cabin, there never has been. There's no passenger registered in that cabin. There's no one ever been there, despite the fact that Laura talked to someone earlier in the day and has seen a passenger there. So Laura's got to deal with the fact that either she's been terribly mistaken about what she thought she saw, or possibly someone on the ship has committed a murder and she's the only witness. The setting for the boat came from two different angles, really. The first was when I was writing my first novel, In a Dot Dot Wood, lots of the reviewers made comparisons to Agatha Christie. And I suppose when I was starting to write The Woman in Cabin 10, I was thinking about everything that Christie does so well, all those settings like Murder on the Orient Express and Death on the Nile, where you have these beautiful, luxurious settings, but they're also very claustrophobic. It's this kind of atmosphere of luxury, but a sort of stifled luxury. There's an element of dread. And so when I started writing The Woman in Cabin 10, I guess partly I wanted to make a kind of homage to Christie and to do a little acknowledgement of what she did so well with her settings. But the other element was when I was plotting the book, I read a number of cases in the news about disappearances of people from cruise ships. And there's this very strange situation with international law where if you're killed in international waters or if there's a crime committed in international waters, the police jurisdiction isn't the country that you left, it's not the country that you're going to. The jurisdiction rests with the place where the boat is registered. And often for tax reasons, that's very small, out of the way places like the Cayman Islands or the Bahamas or places in the Caribbean. And so you can have this situation where a Frenchman has disappeared and perhaps a Hungarian is implicated and the nearest port is maybe Copenhagen. But 2 weeks later, a policeman arrives from the Caribbean. He doesn't speak the language of any of the protagonists in the crime. The crime scene has been cleaned. And so statistically, it's very difficult to solve crimes that happen at sea. So for all those reasons, it seemed to me a really interesting, quite sinister place to set a murder.